writing space, our smart roller for conveys. So that's about, in fact, that should have gone into trial this week with one of the mining groups, and three big mining groups are having a close look at exactly how that goes. And they actually got an accelerating commercialisation grant this week, which is nice, 260k, which certainly helps. Well, in this now, Keith mentioned that Geelong Angels are going to co-invest with us in a medical device one at the moment, so I think that's now closed.
Yeah.
So the investment team will be going through the due diligence and the paperwork on that one. We'll be able to close in that quickly. In augmented reality, based in Shanghai, which is something completely different. It's our platform on your fingernails. So it takes a bit of getting your mind around, but maybe a show or two. So we get involved in all sorts of things. We were speaking earlier about Rangaroo, which for those of you who go to the NYC to Geelong, they presented probably 3 or 4 years ago. And actually didn't even get a place. which staggered me, actually.
Look at them now.
They announced the other day that they've gone past 6 million unique visitors every month on their website. So they're starting to do very well. A little email with the latest investor update the other day, so things are looking okay there. But we'll look at pretty much anything except biotech, because at the moment we don't have the skill set. Well, three of us have invested in one. But as Keith said, Geelong Angel will be investing in a medical device with us. I've done 3 or 4 with Brisbane Angels. Like I said, we've done it with New Zealand Angels, we've done it for people with people in the States. It's not about the money, it's about who you know and leveraging your network. So when startups come to us, and the role for the mining industry was a classic. They presented the Sydney Angels, not before they presented to us. And we said, we'd like to get Sydney Angels involved. They said, no, you guys have a lot more value. We want to run with you guys. And again, that investment happened 6 months ago. BHP, Rio and Fortescue are all waiting for this trial to occur. They're sitting on the sidelines. We got them into all three. Now they're doing the trials. Someone's actually paying us to do the trials. So we went into Rio, which straight to corporate headquarters. So they're looking at it very, very closely. So they're the sort of opportunities we look for. Any particular space. We do syndicate. The beauty of syndication is that you might want 300,000 something now, but if you're going to do a follow-on round and you've got 2 or 3 other angel groups in there, you don't have to go to outside investor group for your next funding round. We were speaking earlier tonight about people talking about going to VCs. It's not required. If you've got 3 angel groups in your investor syndicate already, and they're going to double down on the next round, and they're going to speak to their colleagues, or you might finish up with 5 in the next round, you can conceivably raise $1.5 to $2 million without going outside your existing investor network. So that's what Melbourne Angels do, and good luck with the pitches tonight.
Thank you.
A question for you.
Yes.
How would you describe an angel investor, Morris? Answer that question.
Okay.
Okay.
Where angels are different, and this is something for all fans to understand because it's a pivotal difference. Mm-hmm. Angels put in their own money, not someone else's money. Okay? The angels only get a return if the founder gets a return. Okay? So you talk about VC, investment banks, all the rest of it. They're investing other people's money, and they actually get a commission off those investors to pay their salaries and all the rest of it. So at the end of the day, whether the business goes good, bad or indifferent, they're going to get paid. But the angels, they put their money in, but more importantly, as I just said, it's the intellectual capital. So for them to have the money, they've done something fairly well in business and life, and they understand how business works. But also, they've got a very wide network of colleagues and contacts or whatever that open the doors. Not only in Australia, but worldwide. Classic example. Interestingly enough, we're actually looking at investing in a racing driver late last year, early this year. They're Melbourne based, current Australian, current world champion, and one of the things we actually looked at was actually hooking him up with the Italian Angels, who we know. And one of the three founders of the Italian Angels actually does work for Ferrari. Okay. So that's one phone call.
Yeah.
You mentioned Rome to Rio. Mm. Okay. When we came to do due diligence, we made two phone calls. One was to executive vice president of Microsoft. So he said, if we mention these two names, what would you tell us? Oh, know them well. Okay. Whatever they put their minds to will make money. So that was good. And then we rang the CEO of Lufthansa and said, why do you use this? Question we got was the 3 years ahead of anyone else in the world, and they're never going to catch them up. It doesn't matter how much money and whatever they throw at them, they're never going to catch them up. So that's the value add.
Okay.
Any other questions?
What level do you need an idea or a business to be operating at? What stage of development?
What valuation do you want? If you've actually got an idea, we'll give you a valuation of zero. Because there's plenty of people in the corner that can give you an idea. You've basically got to have some skin in the game. You're really what? The more proof of concept that you've got, so market validation, customer validation, the fact that someone will pay it, you know, call it $9.99 for your solution, that means that there's a market out there. Someone's prepared to pay it. So do the research, do the yards. Okay? A lot of people come to us, and we're probably the earliest investors apart from what we call friends, families, and fools and followers and fans. They're generally the first source of funding. You know, they'll put in $5,000 or $10,000 into, you know, little Billy over there, you know, aunts and uncles and whatever, and hopefully they can turn that into something. But even so, we see guys that, you know, they read the press, they read all the hype. Oh, yeah, you hear these crazy valuations. And, you know, we were talking earlier today. The stats are 2.5% to 3% of startups get funded. And of that, 6 or 7 go bust. 1 gets their money back and 2 make money. So the successful ones are less than 1% of ideas. So if you want to get funded, the question is, how do you get in that top 3 to 5%? Because it's very competitive. Okay? So if someone else is doing the yards and you come along with just an idea, who's going to get the money? And allow time for it to occur. Okay? Because we're investing for an exit and for the founder of the exit, it's more like a marriage rather than, you know, throwing something on BHP or Telstra shares and bringing your stock broken 3 weeks' time and telling the seller. The shares are illiquid. Okay? For us to get a return, the founder needs to get a return. And from an angel investor point of view, we always want a minority stake. We want the founder to be incentivized to work his clacker off. So that he's got, if we win, he wins even bigger. And that's a great outcome for everyone.
What are the kind of exits you look for?
What, in terms of multiples or whatever?
Well, no, in terms of, like, are there, you know, particular exit strategies which are more common or IPO or on-selling or how?
Normally you're looking for a strategic value exit. So that will be for someone who's already in the space. Okay, so that might be a number two or three competitor who wants to get the number one, or the number one guy who doesn't want his lunch cut by someone else and he wants to keep his market share. The other thing I mentioned is that 85 to 90% of exits are for less than 20 million. Okay, so people read all these crazy valuations and whatever, and they get all excited about them, but you know, they don't worry about the exits for 5, 6, 10, or whatever. Still nice exits, but it impacts valuation. And they don't tell you about, you know, the 70 or 80% that basically fall flat in their face.
And what sort of timelines for exits? Usually,
looking 4 to 6 years. After about year six, we'll tend to put a clause into our agreements to say, look, you know, if there's no exit imminent, that you know, there's a mechanism in there to basically either affect the share buyback or something like that. The other thing with an angel is that they're not looking for dividends. So any cash that's in the business actually gets reinvested into growing the business. Okay, so instead of the business being this big, we want it this big, and then we want it this big, and then we want it shitloads big, so someone can buy it. Okay, so someone notices it and takes you out.
How many unicorns have we seen in Australia? It's only a handful.
Crikeys. Atlassian's probably the only one.
Who's that?
Freelancer.
Sorry, unicorns is $1 billion, right?
That'd probably be the only one. And obviously, Freelancer's worth what, $300 or $400 million or something, right? Then you've got the Acomexes of the world and those sorts of ones. There's not too many. And interestingly enough, I think the number of unicorns has sort of doubled in about the last 6 months worldwide. That's crazy.
Yeah, $10 billion.
The silly thing is, it's a lot of money chasing other money. And how those investors are ever going to get a return, I've got no idea. The investment banks are making money because they're charging fees. The investors in the funds, I spoke to someone earlier today. One of the initial VC backers of Google actually made no money in their fund. So figure it out, okay? So one of the seed investors in Google, they got a part capital return, the investors, so they didn't even get the capital back.
So what's your average investment as an angel network? Do you have an average, or is it?
Varies from deal to deal. One of the ones that we spoke about earlier tonight, there was $750,000 in the room. We finished up getting proved back because they took a little bit of overs, but not quite that much. And then as soon as some of the other investors heard what we were putting in, they decided they wanted to double down. And that was when we probably had 30 odd investors, so there's 13 in that syndicate, so now we've got 50 odd. And they're all different stages. Some are fully invested, some are partial invested, some are new members. The thing is, it's not a one in all. Every member makes his own investment decision on every deal. Yeah. And that's the difference between us and if you go to a VC fund, you put your money in. Whoever sits on the investment committee makes a decision, and you're in whether you like it or not. You know, they could be selling drugs, they could be selling cigarettes, whatever, you're in. You don't have a say in the matter. Whereas with an angel group, you actually get to pick and choose how much you want to put in and which investments you want to put into.
Very good. Thanks, Morris. And Jeff is doing the timekeeping.
Well, I've got 2 minutes.
Yes, 2 minutes.
2 minutes.
2 minutes.
I thought I had to get
2 minutes. 30 seconds.
All right, so I'll start. I do a lot of things. I'm a software developer. I've got a co-working space called Startup Cloud. A lot of on-the-side projects. But today I'm talking to you about a community initiative where we want to bring better internet to Geelong sooner. This is called Geelong Wireless. It's for medium businesses. We have partnered with Deakin already. They've shown a lot of interest in this idea. And what I need help with today is getting awareness and some interest in this concept. Some promotion. I'm looking for 100 names to go back to Deakin with to show that there's a market. And in principle interest, I should say. Then we'll come back to those people later. Now, the gap in the market is the NBN is out there, but it's stopping ISPs, telcos, from investing in infrastructure, particularly in the CBD, for example. So for the next 3 to 5 years, there's going to be nothing. So we want to partner with a few people and just help these businesses who have a need to fill that need just for 3 to 5 years. That's why it's a community initiative and not really a money spinner. But I'm sure there's people in the room that know people, graphic artists. There needs to be quite a few people in a building for it to matter. I've talked to a lot of the businesses already, and if there's only 2 or 3 in the building, they're happy with 4G. So we're talking about 10 or more people within a building, office buildings and things like that. So come and talk to me later if that interests you, if you know someone. Mm. Thanks. Mm. Any questions? Mm.
Who are you aiming at? Who's your customers for this? Is it, at the end of the day, is it individuals or businesses?
Businesses in the CBD.
Geelong. CBD business, that's
in Geelong. That's right.
CBD.
Yep. And Jeff over here as well, he's we've got a few ideas between us. Jeff's also got a special place in his heart for industry parks as well, which are underserviced. Mm-hmm. Anyone else?
So you're planning on installing extra towers, is that the idea?
There's a lot of ideas for technology. There's
lots of different ways to
latent fibre in the ground.
Okay.
There's probably going to be a mixture of fibre and wireless. And,
okay.
and
yep.
Deakin already has some bandwidth we can use, and we can build on top of that. They're like an anchor tenant for the backhaul.
Yep.
So Todd, how do you have an unfair advantage over your competitors?
Well, it's more about the problem that's the issue, that the problem that's there is not addressed. Telstra could actually come in. In fact, we're actually going to go to some of the big telcos and say, here's our list of 100 names, because we'd rather not do it ourselves, but they need to be able to do it at the right terms that the customers expect. If they can't deliver, then this model is actually on the rise in the US. It's called the municipal ISP, where the council or government is running it. For example, in the US, there's a place where you can get gigabit speed internet for $40 a month. The NBN, the same thing, well, they don't go to gigabit, but it'll be $200 a month for 100. So you can see there's obviously competition involved and a lot of other factors, but we're really representing the customers, the market who show interest in this concept or pretty much show that there's a big need there.
Todd, is there a lack of speed and cost and service from an IT perspective?
In some places, particularly
in Geelong.
My co-working space, we have 25 desks.
Right.
We've got what's at a level of 3.6 megabit.
Yeah, yeah.
We'd love to have 8 or 40.
Okay.
And it's not possible to get that, not without a lot of cost.
Right.
So it's about bringing the cost down so that a good level of upload speed can be achieved. Because if everyone's uploading Dropbox at the same time, it actually kills downloads.
Okay.
For all sorts of technical reasons. But there are a lot of businesses. I spent an hour talking to a lot of businesses in Geelong. And a lot of them said, we don't have a problem. I said, great, this isn't for you. We keep walking on. And I've got a list, I'm shortlisting some ideas of some businesses to visit. It's very hard to talk to some small businesses and say,
yeah, okay.
Just finish this question if that's all right. It's hard to go to some businesses because their IT department's somewhere else.
Okay.
It's going to be really difficult to really connect and get all that information on place. That's the value I'm adding personally,
mm-hmm.
to bring all that together, to bring the case, bring all the, bring the business. Ask more questions later.
Thanks,
Scott.
Thank you.
Yeah,
Scott.
So I think we can start from this end, and we can do it.
Well,
what are we doing, a pitch?
Didn't you bring yours?
You should be pitching.
Yeah, everyone is doing it.
Okay.
So, you can start.
Okay.
Thank you. I'm new to this group. My name's Andrew. I've got a company called Project Advantage. I've been working in the project management consultancy space for about 15, 20 years. Just to address some of these issues here, what problem are you solving? Well, we go into organisations and we help to address the competency levels of project staff, really. We put systems in place, we put policies in place, and help to organisations to deliver their projects a lot better, on time, on budget, quality, all that sort of project management stuff. Who's your customer target market? Well, I've been working with the mining industry, the local government, government space, the manufacturing industry, and varieties of other general business across the board. So I work not only here in Geelong and Melbourne, I also work right across Australia. So who's our competitor? From our competitors, from a probably currently, I would say our competitors are internet-based and they're large organisations. They're like the big educational organisations that are actually taking a lot of our business. So we're actually driven back to networking like this to make connections with organisations so we can build those relationships. How are you better than them? Well, I'm not too sure. We actually deliver the same sort of service, but we actually go on site and we put systems in place and we stay on site for anything from 3 to 12 months. How do you make money? We make money by delivering Microsoft Project training products, project methodology training products, and we make money by consulting. So we go in contract and we deliver 3 to 12 month contracts. And that's who we are. So I'm actually looking at doing further work into Geelong. I'm from Ocean Grove, so into Geelong and into Melbourne instead of having to travel all over the place. I've only just come back from Tasmania. I'm heading to South Australia to do work. I'd rather do work here. So that's me, and I can give you my card after this.
Okay.
Any questions? No? Thank you.
I don't have a pitch.
That came quick. So my name is Ajit Singh. I'm a psychiatrist, and I've spent the last 9 years trying to figure out ways of reducing trial and error prescribing by using genetics. The World Health Organization projects that there are about 350 million people with major depression. And in Australia, about 10% of adults are on antidepressants now. They're only required where counselling and lifestyle modifications fail. The problem is we all vary in how we respond to antidepressants, and months and years can pass during a trial and error process to find the right medication at the right dose. Over the last 9 years, I've done a doctorate, a postdoctorate, and just completed a proprietary data set, a clinical trial that demonstrates the efficacy of my method called CNS Dose, which is a trade secretive method of turning gene variant data into a medication prescribing report to take away trial and error prescribing from doctors and patients. At the moment the website's being developed, the next step is look for sales traction direct to patients and doctors to use that then to try and leverage a deal with a lab chain. We're already in discussions with two US lab chains pending initial traction. So I'm very hopeful that this can be a scalable growth industry, not only to help people with depression, but create a bit of a biotech startup hub here in Geelong. That's it in a nutshell. But I'm happy to field questions. Probing ones are welcome.
Mm-hmm.
Depression only? So essentially today, I did a randomised controlled trial. It was actually published today in a peer-reviewed journal, and it's just looking at antidepressants. There are over 30 antidepressants to choose from. And every one is like a different key, and every brain is like a different lock.
Yeah, I understand, because I'm aware of the state government project that's been going for a couple of years now, where they're trying to do the same thing in terms of mapping DNA back to the different medicines that patients are taking, because they're finding some medicines that the physicians are giving them are actually doing them more harm than good based on their DNA. And so
there'd be the Sheffields with DNA Dose. So there's a company. So there are multiple startups. Earlier this year, the FDA in America announced that they're going to regulate the space. So up until now, anybody could say, I've got a genetic test that does good. Now the FDA is going to want peer-reviewed scientific evidence. So this creates a very tight oligopoly globally. So I think that gives a heads up. There's a lot of startups that have said, look, we've got this genetic method, it works, but you just have to trust them. They haven't got a peer review publication which has been vetted, due diligence process scientifically. So I'm hoping that'll give an edge. And then really the real exit would be if an existing player. So the main player is a company called GeneSight in the US. They've done $400 million worth of sales of their version of the report, but they don't have a randomised controlled trial to back the validity of it.
There's something that happens and they get sued?
So I've gone the other way around. I've spent 9 years doing the hard yards to get the science right.
So what will it take you to go through FDA or TGA here?
Currently, there are no requirements for a clinical decision support system guidance. So if you've got a novel molecule or a novel device, you have to demonstrate safety and efficacy.
Yeah.
At the moment, it's wild, wild west, and that's why they're bringing in regulations which are going to be really retrofitted to peer-reviewed literature. So the regulations are emerging, they're not yet in place.
you had a question.
Yeah,
you
know. Is that okay?
Yeah, yeah.
Ajit, who's your target market? Is it the medical practitioners and the psychiatrists, or is it the actual end user in this?
Well, I think initially to show that there's a demand, I'll be targeting prescribers and patients to see if there's some sales traction. And then if we've got some sales traction, the real sort of consumer, I think, will be the lab chains.
No.
You don't think so?
You will. You know who's going to pay you? The bloody health funds.
Mm-hmm.
It's a major cost to them.
Absolutely.
Yeah, well, that's right. So it's another angle is whether health funds subsidise the testing to reduce the total cost of care.
Correct.
But those spaces are, I guess, where I need help. I'm a clinician and a part-time scientist and a beginner businessman. Mm. And I guess that's the real reason I'm here to get ideas like that.
Come and talk to us.
One of the night because I'm totally unprepared.
That's all right.
Come on. As business is everyone else here. So, my company is Dental Integrated Services. It sounds very fancy, but at the moment it's me. Mm-hmm. And Todd is my developer. We've developed version one of a program called Happn, which is an online ordering solution for dentists, dental practices to use to make ordering their products easy from the supplier. So. Basically, I describe it as iSelect, but for buying dental products. They can compare prices very quickly, very easily, and then also combining a very automated system, very easy to use. The aim is that anyone could walk in off the street, a dentist could say, order me some polyvinylsiloxane. You have no idea what that is, but you can go to the computer, find the best price, find the quickest supplier to get it out to you, and it will appear in the next week, hopefully. So, target market is dental practices and also dental suppliers. My competitor, there is a company called Hellas Henry Schein, which is a big dental supplier. They have an online ordering system, however, it's only for their products, so it's quite biased. So that's how I'm better than them. I'm not biased. I'll be comparing it with every supplier, and also with the having a dental nursing background, there's a lot of extra features that I'll be able to implement into the software package to make it better for the user. How am I going to make money? I'm going to charge dentists, and I'll probably take a percentage of sales from the suppliers for every product that we sell that's sold throughout our website, and also there's a potential of moving into inventory management systems as well using SensorMap technologies, and I'll leave it there.
So how do you keep the database current, because you know if you're going to have multiple suppliers in there with different products or whatever, how are you going to make sure that you've got up-to-date pricing in there?
Incentivize
the suppliers to keep it up to date.
Will they give you an API and actually go into their system or whatever?
No, we'll make them update it for us.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Okay. So you have an API into
the
system.
Which
what's your
website?
They go
to the website like eBay.
Yeah.
They go to the website.
So in that case, will you be putting in agreements with vendors that go into that, that they have to honour those prices that are actually on the website as well?
I
would
imagine so.
So it's one of the biggest quality issues.
Yeah, we will worry about those two days later.
Yeah. Well, it might, probably might be in price, like a reseller of airfares. Perhaps. Is that what you're fishing for?
Well,
more
because, you know, if Sony accidentally puts the wrong price, in an automated system, it's obviously going to come up as the cheapest. So then, is that final sale? How do you get around that? It's
perhaps
like,
they approve it on their end to finalise it with supply. But yeah, that's just detail. Which we can work through yet. But it's definitely valid.
iSelect are actually biased because they only promote the products of organisations they have an arrangement with. They get paid to do that.
Correct.
Yeah.
So,
and they promote the ones that they make more money out of.
That's
right.
A revenue stream for you, is really what I'm saying.
Yeah.
So is a fun, sorry, bad idea. Is a fundamental clipping a tick on the way through that you make the money? Or you, I take it you're not supplying the goods?
No.
So you're clipping the ticket.
By
providing a portal fundamentally. And I presume, from your knowledge of the industry, is industry happy to lose a bit of their margin for easy ordering, do you think? Or?
Well, the problem is with the dentists, they've got card systems and things like that.
Yeah.
And there's time being wasted. So that's where we think the money would be from first, but we could take transaction percentages, but we haven't worked that through the details too much.
Is it newly developed?
Monthly charge.
I've got
a okay.
Card, so
okay.
To
have access to the service.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Because it's a level market, competition drives out the prices anyway. So.
And is that only local suppliers or international as well?
Yeah, international.
The freight's going to kill
you.
Well, I mean, it will have to be international because there's only some dental products that you can get from Germany.
Yeah, okay.
So,
yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
I was just wondering how you funded development up until this point. Is that just out of your own pocket?
I quit
or
my job.
Yeah.
Yes.
You married
him.
You married a developer.
That's brilliant.
G'day folks, I'm Andrew. Call me AB, much easier. I respond much, much better. If you call me Andrew, I can come in trouble.
Yeah.
My business is called Web Credit. Nothing to do with finance at all. The credit part of it actually is webcred.it. It's up and running, so I've got the finance. The credit bit is actually to do with giving someone credit, like credits on a movie. So the word credit comes from the word credibility in terms of your recognition. The problem that we're solving is in fact recognition.